menos.
Yo, yo, yo.
Oh, me.
Do you think that identical strategies like selection cell are undergoing this process? Of, I'm pretty sure you used, you know, say,
how big is it?
It's so big and how big is it? So we were talking about the cell without a complement, but could this be an example of that?
Or yeah,
I
so,
wouldn't
so,
want to take care of such a child.
Right, so those empty bullets right there, I mean, I was going to put so right there, but yeah, they're exactly, yeah, yeah, that's the third one is so good. Yeah, but that's the idea, yes, that that you would have, and so starts out as a modal indexical, right? And then acquires this, frees itself from having context-dependent referent to become something else. So again, but for each case, one would have to really identify, well, what is the discourse referent that is identified at the indexical stage? And then what is it that happens when that indexical connection is lost? But if you know the overarching story is correct, then you could do it across a variety of domain and then have an explanation for this recurring intuition that historical linguists have, that expressions that are associated with the here and the now, that are restricted, that are specific in some way, seem to lose that restriction and specificity over time. So it's a way of kind of packaging that intuition.
Thank you for the talk. It was lovely and a wonderful way to wrap up this event. But I have a question about definiteness. I need you to help me see how to not think of definites as having discretionary indexicality.
So in a way, what definites, so this is like, you know, the use of weak definites and the wheel of a car and so on as well, right? So those uses clearly do not have discretionary indexicality.
Sorry, which ones don't?
You need to see the doctor. And also the
corner of a busy intersection and so on, right? Where you don't have, well, in those cases, you don't even have uniqueness satisfied, right? But in all each of these cases, you don't have discretionary indexical content at all. Whereas with demonstrative that, you have to establish the reference based on the speaker connection. So it's not that the definite article cannot be used to refer to an entity that is that the speaker is seeking to refer to, but it's that it can do far more beyond that. So it does not depend on the establishment of reference for the demonstration. So the accompanying demonstration is not necessary. That's it.
Well, so the idea is the definite has a semantic spread includes cases which do not require any concentration of speakers' attention.
And that's again a generalization in the way that the progressive to the imperfective is a generalization, right? So the definite allows for all these uses, but then there's the demonstrative that comes in and blocks its uses in certain contexts, right? Maybe those which require an accompanying demonstration, and the demonstrative becomes the better device to use that.
Well,
at
this point, there are still lots of uses of definites. That require demonstration in your book, so.
That are compatible with an accompanying demonstration.
So I'm thinking, for example, the dog is biting another dog, where clearly the speaker has one of the available dogs in mind as the dog to the dog.
Yeah.
You know, cases like, I say, Bill's very annoyed with his father, the old fool just bought a new Cadillac. Mm-hmm. So the old fool, there are two potential antecedents, so clearly one is.
Yeah.
So is the point just that, yes, there are still those uses of definites, but there are also the very weak ones?
I think that is the point, that you get informational uniqueness to be a sufficient condition for the use of the, right? And that allows for a broadening of the set of uses. I mean, I'm really telling you what John Stevens says, because it's so that part of is completely taken from him. But the idea is to, you know, apply it across domains.
I don't know if I can formulate this so late in the day. Let's see what happens. I'm trying to take your story and sort of shove it into the brains of the language users. So we're not just talking about the language uses this or gains this anymore. We're saying at some point, speakers of an earlier variety start doing things, start improvising new things, such that the learner now says, oh, I don't need discretionary indexical content anymore on this word. Or they don't even recognize that that's a necessary feature because of something that the speakers of the previous generation are doing that's not entirely the way they learned it. Okay? At some point, somebody has to go beyond what they've learned, improvise something new. The next generation interprets it some other way and says, oh, this doesn't need indexical. I mean, it maybe never occurs to them
that's
a requirement. This seems to be a theme that I've brought up many times in the past few days. What's the mechanism that people, when people are improvising and going beyond their grammar, and how does that get understood and how does that get passed on?
So, I mean, I'll just restrict myself to this set of situations, this set of domains. And I think it's a very, I don't think we have any answer to the question of what does it mean to say that, or how does exactly a certain kind of content get lost. So we are really at the stage of trying to say, well, what is the content that gets lost, right? So to say, how is it that it gets lost? To ask that question, one has to say, well, how frequent, for instance, are the accompanying demonstrations for the use of a particular demonstrative element, right? When I say the demonstrative, it's the progressive, the star, or dem. Yeah? How frequent is it? How successful are the uptakes of these demonstrations? And the more you, if the broader the use of the demonstrative, maybe people take.
Right.
You're
no,
really forcing me out on a limb here. I'm happy to go, but.
I think you want to swim. I really want to understand this.
Yeah, no, me too.
Right. What does it mean when it says people broadened it out?
Yeah, I see. Yes.
Okay.
So one thing that what's being around, and I think actually is about to articulate it, but let me push it further into the limb, is that. This lexical content has a very interesting. has a very interesting juice, right? It's a communicative juice. And a demonstration of that would be to say, just pay attention. He said, pay attention. Distraction, pay attention. There is a communicative juice there. It's a communicative strategy there. That, of course, says, OK, so now we're talking. You use it once because the system allows you to use it. So you're on the different path. And then you begin to start, as we have seen it for the progressive for the set and start, you begin to expand. You don't just colonize the whole domain,
right?
You start with the predicates that allow you that you where this usage is maximally effective. And then you begin to expand. But as we know, the more you do this, the less effective it becomes. So it's a matter of just victim of its own success.
That's not just me, but also the stuff.
So it's not a mechanism, right? The mechanism is the indexical content, as the Shrinks call it.
Yeah.
That is a mechanism. And what happens is that it's too much. and then you lose it, and then something else has to be recruited to serve that purpose. That's the idea. What do you see?
Yeah. I think that so one of the ways in which you can think about it is that the if there is a possibility of certain kinds of populations, for instance, child population, not being able to take up the accompanying demonstration, then the nature of the presupposition will change, right? Because part of the presuppositional content, I mean, we haven't said that this is presuppositional, but most of the indexical content that one has is typically presuppositional in nature. And so this kind of content is going to depend on the hearer's ability to align with the speaker and identify the reference. So if there are systematic populations that don't have the ability to do that with such prowess, then you might get the weakening of the presupposition. And so in the case of the demonstrator, you're moving from demonstrativeness to simple uniqueness, right? So the ability to establish a specific discourse reference simply to the information that there is a unique reference that meets the descriptive properties of the noun phrase in the context, right? Which is a much weaker presupposition. So working out each kind of step in that would take time, but right now if one can think of it in terms of weaker and weaker presuppositions as being the discrete steps in the change, then one might say, well, okay, well, how do we move from this discrete, richer presupposition to this discrete, weaker presupposition? But that's about where I was top of my list.
Two points I want to make. One is that just listening to this and thinking about points in sign language, right? How they stop pointing, sign language after sign language adopts pointing from the gestural community, and then they end up being the definite. You know, they in many sign languages, and you just watching pointing in Nicaraguan sign very rapidly lose this, that one over there, and start to mean this. It gets smaller and more reduced, and so it's time to think about how consistent that is with the story. But my other point is really a response to Ray's point on the bigger sense, right? Again, like, why does it ever change? Why does anyone ever do a new thing? And I think it's it really has to do with the learner giving a narrower or more bleach or something interpretation to the thing that they're parsing, right? So in some way. So especially when there's redundancy in the system, which there's going to be, you can attribute that part of the message to the redundant element, right? And so again, as that demonstrative gets less and less powerful, you'll bring in a second demonstrative, right? And then you can attribute all the demonstrativeness to that second thing. And that makes this first one really lose its power even more. So I'm thinking again about the locatives in Nicaraguan sign, where you associate people, you're talking about an event with these different people in these different locations, and those locations suddenly get really bleached out, and they're not about locations at all, and then you're just pointing in order to have the reference and so suddenly all that locativeness is no longer a verb, and then you verbs at the end of your sentence. So it's not like someone decides, oh, I'm going to put these other things in. I think it's that the child is saying these things aren't in there already because I'm not interpreting this monster that's having that in it. So now I'm going to put in another method, right? I think it's a cycle like that. So it's actually not adding stuff, it's subtracting stuff.
That's right.
Getting more and more narrow.
But the I think I'm going to put in another is going outside the grammar that you have and making up something new. So that's the part.
Right, but it's going to be opportunistic, right? There's going to be the affordances of the system there about what that new thing is going to be, right? And the thing that's in the queue to be recruited for that new function, it's not. It's creative, but it's creative in its creativity through constraint,
right?
It's
not random.
Yeah.
It's not like, oh, maybe I'm gonna change my order. Like, I know I've always put the object way over here, but I'm gonna put it over here. Like, it's not like that kind of doing something new. It's I'm not gonna analyze that as an object anymore. So now I need to put an object in.
If that's something like the right story, I don't understand how these changes take place over such a long period of time. Because we're talking about this, like a child learner can't sort of bleach the demonstrative just a little bit, or reinterpret it just a little bit.
So I think I can add something here that maybe clarifies everything that everybody's talking about. And it's actually related to your comments that we don't know what broadening is. I have to disagree. I think actually John Wiley has a very nice account of what broadening is, and that's basically habituation, which is what is being discussed here to some extent. But it also explains why it's not a change is not so quick and categorical as if it goes going from one generation to the other and very slow. Because habituation is basically, as a result of frequency, the response that you get from the listener is not as strong as it should have been, so the form weakens in conveying the meaning as it's expressed more and more and more. And so that's a slow process, and at the same time, I think it does show how things get broader and lose meaning.
Right.
And
so,
mechanism,
so but then that kind of seems to, I don't know if that's what you mean, but suppose you have a particular expression or a gesture, right, that's interpreted in a particular way. With a demonstration, it acquires its discourse reference. Now, is the probability that the hearer will successfully grasp the intended referent something that you want to vary over time? I mean, that would be very interesting, right? I mean, what would it be that would lead to that probability of successful communication to vary over time for that particular expression? Right? What is it that would change the probability of the hearer grasping it? If there's the presence of another device, or there's innovation, all of that would change the probability. But I think in the absence of anything else.
Yeah, so I think associative learning could have an answer here to this question, where if a stimulus is presented over and over again, it loses its power, basically. That's really simple. Kind of cue outcome relationship. As the frequency of the cue goes higher, the kind of the response to that stimulus weakens. So that's basically habituation, and I think Wiley connects it very nicely to broadening.
Yeah, I mean, all I would say is that, you know, one wants to understand, well, first of all, the way in which the habituation is taken. I mean, what is successful communication going to be? Successful communication in this case is going to be success in identifying the reference that is communicated. Okay? And if we want to change the rate of that success and habit to go hand in hand with habituation, then we would need to kind of make reference to other elements of the context, but I mean all kinds of things in order to. I don't quite see what it is that would. Prevent you from aligning yourself with the speaker given a single
variability, device. Variability, I think. I mean, variability is inherent to language. In every aspect of language, there's always variability. There's always, nothing is either 100% or zero. So if we add that variability, then there's opportunity for
But you want it to go in a particular direction. It's not just stochastic, right? I mean, you want it to just kind of reduce over time. I mean, all I would want is a better explanation for that, why it reduces over time, than just habituation. Because I think habituation is more like habituation because of increase in frequency doesn't give me a kind of a grasp on what exactly is happening. But we can talk about that.
So here's a way to go. Use Lynn's idea and say, well, the extensions are just sort of speech errors. People that are on the fringe of what's good, and they go, they digress a little bit. The language learner says, oh, you can say that, can you? And incorporates that broader domain into the grammar.
So which element are we talking about? The innovation of a device or the change in the meaning of the device?
Either one. Either one. It's, you know, just as through just sort of looking for some way to say it, you transgress the boundary. And then the learner says, oh, that's part of the language.
Like double negatives. Mm-hmm. Like a double negative,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
If you can have a double negative, and then you start to require the double negative, right? And then you shift in which part of the double negative is the one that you need, and then the other one disappears, right? So
what's the boundary that you're transgressing? I mean, that's actually
well,
the
number of cases.
For a stack, what's the boundary? Over set. So you still have to talk about the specific. So I don't.
Oh, yeah,
I
yeah.
think talking about this as an error. It's too blunt. It's something. It's something more nuanced that leads for that
like
for the choice of that specific predicate.
Right.
It becomes predicate specific. I choose to use a star in this one. That's the innovation, and then why this one? And so that's exactly what it is. That's the to describe that.
Yeah.
So we know,
right.
of course, that it's
so,
transgression.
Well,
there has to be some transgression.
Well,
but
right, but the transgression is wanting indexical content to something that's really not entirely appropriate to it. Let's say.
Yes, it's highlighting the way that Thurston Dahl talks about. You know, that you get this enriched form, and then over time, then that's just reduced to having the default meaning that you started out with expressed by a different form, and so you lose, again, the heightened meaning associated with the as
right.
you were just saying, with the Jespersen cycle type of example. But I think I would work with Estar as well, that Estar is kind of pointing to something that Ser on its own couldn't give you.
But so what you want to basically say is, so it's not just frequency, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's frequency driven by a particular communicative advantage
that
is enjoyed by the form, right? So in the domain of Jespersen cycle, again,
right.
emphatic negation is something that allows you to widen the domain
right.
over which
right.
You know something doesn't obtain.
Right.
So you want those kind of substantive things to drive the increase in the use, which would then lead to habituation, not have frequency and habituation simply as kind of running as the drivers of the beginning of meaning. So if we are able to identify what it is that Estar does that gives us this extra kick that makes us want to use it again and again, then we are good on saying yes, and then we get habituated to it, and therefore it begins.
Or the next generation.
And the next year for the next generation to have a different kind of.
We need to continue
yeah.
with
yeah.
our pizza and beer.